Until now, we've been working on a single machine. It's time to start thinking about scaling up and scaling out. So let's bring our expert Adrian back in.
Hi there.
Hey Adrian, thanks for coming back. What role do you see containers playing in the future of application development and deployment?
Well, if you look at the history of having large systems in the data center, bare metal machines, they would typically, you'd buy them, you'd depreciate them over 3 years, they'd sit at the same IP address, they get installed once and used over and over again. And you can think of those machines as pets. What we really want to do is have cattle, right? So if you lose some, you know, one cow out of a dairy herd, you still got milk, right? You go and get another cow. That's that kind of model, rather than having some machine that's very specific and everyone knows its name, and if ever anything goes wrong with it, everyone gets very unhappy. So that transition from sort of these very specific machines to more sort of fleets of or herds of machines is something that happened typically when, you know, you can do it with VMs, but VMs take hours. You know, basically you usually get them by the hour and they last for a few weeks, and you know, they have a much shorter life cycle. But when we got to containers, became efficient enough that you could actually get a machine in seconds and you could run it for minutes, and that was a perfectly reasonable thing to do. So you can create an entire test environment from scratch, run it end to end, run all your tests, shut it down again, and you can have lots of those running in parallel. So now you've got machines, some of them without even, you know, you barely know they exist, they come and go very, very quickly. And finally, sort of if you take it right to the limit, you could create a container just to run a single request and shut it down again. And that's, you know, something that's starting to be called serverless computing. And there's a few frameworks for doing that. It's a kind of, but that's sort of the bleeding edge of what's happening right now.
So when it comes to writing containerized apps, other than make it smaller, what are problems that no one's talking about?
So one of the problems is that people get into is if they keep their old organization and the old practices. So if you've got a microservice or an application you're building, and the way you used to build your monolith was you had teams spread all around the world that contributed code into the system, and you spent, you know, weeks or of putting everything together. So when we created software, it sort of followed the form, that form. This is sometimes called Conway's Law, which says that the structure of an organization guides the kind of structure of the code they produce. So what I'm really saying is that you can't build microservices with a waterfall organization.
So people might lose some of the benefits of a microservices pattern with organizational issues. Mm-hmm. What about technical issues like monitoring, logging? What are problems with those?
So you need much more automation. There's a lot more moving parts. You need systems that dynamically discover what to be monitored and, you know, and track them. So that's the kind of characteristic you're looking for.
That sounds like a lot goes into it. Is this something developers are programming themselves?
We're looking back 5 years when Netflix first started doing this. One of the things we had was that because we were early, we had to invent a lot of stuff ourselves. And there was just, you know, we went and read papers and we built things, right? And what the situation now is that there's really too many things to choose from. And you spend more time trying to figure out which GitHub repo has something useful in it, which open source project, and which you know, SaaS vendor is trying to sell you something. So there's just too many choices right now. And those choices are changing really rapidly.
So it sounds like infrastructure is something really important, maybe not to code yourself because there's so much. So yeah. To find something that works, use it for now, change or readjust as you go.
Yeah, there's no need to build it yourself now. There's too many good options out there, too many things you can just get hold of and use. There are cloud-based services, there's on-premise, there's things you can download for free. So, you know, something like Kubernetes has a lot of functionality. You can just go use it, and you don't have to go try and build all that yourself. So we're building higher and higher level services on top of lots of detailed engineering work goes into building these frameworks, and then you can build on top of them.
Okay, thank you so much for coming in and talking to me about this.
All right, thanks very much.
After talking with Adrian, one of the industry's leading experts on this subject, it turns out that infrastructure is just as important as the application itself. This course is going to cover the theory and implementation of managing that infrastructure. So in this course, we're going to move past theory and show you how to do it. And we'll be using Kubernetes for that.